Even the smallest homestead can and probably should have some livestock. Bees, for example, can really help a garden and fruit trees produce and take up a minimum of space and time. Pigeons or squab can be kept in urban settings. Rabbits are small, quiet, and don't require overly large pens. Their manure is probably some of the least offensive in the barnyard to manage, and it's fantastic for the garden beds. Rabbits are usually allowed within city limits, too, being considered pets rather than livestock. And rabbits can be fiber animals, such as with the Angora breed, as well as those breeds raised for meat. A small flock of laying hens, say 3 to 6 birds, can often be kept in an average suburban backyard, either in a permanent coop or a glorified rabbit hutch, or in a movable chicken tractor. They will keep a small family in eggs as well as provide fodder for the compost pile, or in the case of a mobile coop, fertilize the spent garden beds as they're moved over top of them. If one is discreet, it may even be possible to keep a small flock covertly, despite zoning to the contrary. A close friend of mine has been doing just that for years on a regular city lot in the middle of town. Besides hens, she's even kept ducks in a privacy fence enclosed backyard. Now, I'm not advocating that you do that. I'm just saying. And frankly, in a manure-hitting-the-rotary-blade scenario, are you really going to care about zoning at that point? Incidentally, during the first Great Depression, chickens were almost as common in town as they were in the rural areas. If you have a few acres of open land, and again, zoning permitting, or better yet, no zoning, you can keep more chickens or larger animals, such as sheep, pigs, or a few dairy goats. If your land isn't open, however, don't rule out goats, as they actually prefer brushy undergrowth to grass. Like deer, they're browsers. And some breeds of pigs were developed to live in woodlots, feasting on acorns, grubs, and whatever else they could scrounge up. On larger acreages, say from 5 acres and up, with at least half in good pasture, a homesteading prepper can consider raising a beef steer or dairy cow, or having a couple of horses. Now, pasture requirements are going to vary from place to place, depending on the climate, available forage, and water availability. In my neck of the woods, here in West Michigan, it takes approximately 2 acres of reasonably good pasture to maintain either one horse or cow or 6 sheep or goats through the late spring to early fall. That's barring unusual weather conditions that adversely affect plant growth, of course. In a northern region, like where I live, you'll need to store feed for the winter months, which accounts for approximately half of the year. So this is something the northern homesteading prepper needs to consider in selecting livestock. The questions become, can I raise enough feed on my property to feed my animals year-round? Or if not, do I have the capacity to store what I can't produce for a certain period until spring or summer and fresh forage becomes available again? And if I'm going to need to purchase feedstuffs for the winter, is my supplier reliable and easily accessible? An Amish neighbor with abundant hay fields worked with draft teams isn't likely to be as affected by rising oil prices. But the typical modern farmer might just decide it's not worth it anymore to raise hay, with his commercial fertilizer prices doubling as well as the diesel for his tractors. Something to think about. So ideally, you produce as much as possible of what you need for your animals because it's a bit precarious to rely on outside sources for your animal feed. Unfortunately, that is my own situation, and I've always felt it's our homestead's Achilles heel. A self-sustaining homestead is a self-sufficient homestead. Now, in the case of animals being raised for slaughter, however, sometimes the year-round feed dilemma isn't a concern. Broiler chickens, for example, are ready for slaughter in about 8 weeks, depending on breed. Raising a homestead hog requires roughly 6 months of feeding, say from April to October, which is enough time for the 40-pound feeder pig to become the 200-pound hog. These months tend to be the most productive on the homestead, so feeding a pig or pigs from garden surplus, excess eggs and milk, as well as household scraps, helps to create future pork in an economical way and without a long-term commitment. Likewise, lambs born in the early spring and raised on pasture are usually ready for market by fall. Some breeds of sheep, like the Icelandic, have evolved to reach market weight on mom's rich milk and good pasture alone, with no grain necessary. So don't forget to consider the temporary type of livestock when selecting what to bring home. Speaking of bringing animals home, if you take nothing else away from this video, let it be this one thing. Do your homework. It is in your best interest, not to mention the animals, to know how to take care of and handle the animal before you bring it home. I cannot stress this enough. Also, research breeds. There's a reason why there's so many breeds of livestock out there. It's because they all have differing characteristics that may make them perfect for your situation / homestead, or likewise, may make them a complete disaster for you to try to raise. You need to know what breed of and type of animals would be best suited for your situation. Along this line, learn what is a good specimen of the animal you are considering. Not just what is conformationally or functionally correct, but also what are the signs and characteristics of a healthy versus unhealthy animal. And here's a biggie to livestock raising success that many people ignore. Have the appropriate pen, feed, water source, basic veterinary supplies, and equipment in place before you bring the animal home. Makeshift fencing, overcrowding, and difficult watering or feeding arrangements, to name a few circumstances, can quickly make for a very bad situation. Bad for you and bad for the animal. In my opinion, ill-preparedness and ignorance kills, injures, and makes sick more animals and people on the homestead than any other thing when it comes to animal husbandry. Granted, everybody learns by hands-on doing, but don't neglect educating yourself with a basic knowledge base regarding the animals you want to keep before, there's that word again, before you get to the point of actually physically having them. Not doing so at the very least can be a costly and discouraging experience. At worst, you or someone in your household could get killed or hurt. Keeping animals is not the place to learn as you go, at least not completely from scratch. To that end, let's go over some titles. Now, I'm not going to be going into great detail with these books, simply because there are so many. Okay, if you are setting up your homestead, or getting ready to add livestock or more livestock to an existing one, a very helpful book is How to Build Animal Housing by Carol Ekarius, copyright 2004, and retailing for just under $16.50 from Amazon.com. It includes 60 plans for coops, hutches, barns, sheds, pens, feeders, and much more. One nice thing about this book that I especially appreciate is that many of the projects are portable or built on skids. That's great if you plan on doing rotational grazing or want to move animals around from pen to pen or pasture to pasture to cut down on parasite load. Your animal's shelters can just follow them along. Also, if your zoning is fussy about the number of or total square footage of permanent outbuildings allowed, movable pens are often a way around this obstacle. Anything on skids is usually considered a temporary structure and therefore isn't counted as an outbuilding on your property. Also, because they aren't stationary and anchored permanently to the earth, such structures can't or shouldn't add to the increased assessment of your property in regards to taxes. I don't know about where you live, but it seems like for us, if we mow our lawn, our assessment goes up. Well, maybe not so much anymore. Finally, with movable shelters, if you're renting, you can take your animal pens with you when you move, or sell them. Another noteworthy book on this topic of structures, specifically for poultry, which is where many homesteading preppers start with livestock, is Chicken Coops by Judy Pangman, copyright 2006, and retailing for $13 from Amazon.com. There's lots and lots of coop designs given for all size flocks, settings, and budgets. Oh, we're out of time already. On to part 2 in the next video.